Amen. She said, what she couldn't do, God went on and did it when she went and kicked the garbage. Amen. God is good. All right. You know, it's kind of funny. Today's message and this morning, you know, I was truly blessed. Belief. Talking about belief. Somebody look at somebody say, believe. And when we talked about belief being manifested, when you believe something, it should be manifested through your behavior. Amen? And we said, and I love how he said, we believe unto righteousness, but we confess unto salvation. We believe, when you believe something, it ought to be manifested. And what you're saying out of your mouth should testify to the behavior in which you believe. When you believe something, it should be shown in your behavior. And we talked about that. And then it's funny because on Thursday, and as my sister was talking about on Thursday, and God gave me a message, and he had me speak on bits and pieces of it on Thursday. And I'm going to, as with the leading of the Holy Spirit, combine, and I want us to understand both of these messages and believing and understanding. Because how many of you know that we have to get to the place where we believe God? Amen? No. We have to get to the place where we believe the Word of God, to the place that we are manifesting what we believe. We are showing what we believe. We're standing on what we believe. And let me tell you the greatest thing. We have to get to the place that when you believe something, people see what you believe in you. You know what I'm saying? When we talked about, we don't want no more what? Talk. No more talk service. No more people talking about, I love you or I care about you and I feel this. You have to demonstrate. Jesus demonstrated his love. He demonstrated, meaning that what his love for us was manifested through demonstration. He took action. And when the action, when you look at the actions that he took, man revealed that he absolutely loved humanity. When you look at the actions that he took, sending his son, shows that he absolutely loved humanity. And I want us to understand that, but I want us to go here. I'm kind of, God's going to bring it all together, and we're going to see where the Lord just take us and bring it at the end. Let's turn our Bibles to Genesis, the 22nd chapter, just to understand it from a perspective, from this perspective. And we're going to start reading at the first verse. Of Genesis, the 22nd chapter. And I want y'all to say, they say Abraham is the father of what?
Faith.
I can't hear you.
Faith.
So if I want to learn about what I should be believing in and having faith, Abraham is a good person to study that God kind of developed in faith. And when he developed them in faith, we understand how, you know, that how it was possible for him to stand in it and reflect it and represent it. And also many of us see that Abraham's journey was not a journey all the way always believing in faith. Y'all know that, right? Abraham's journey was when he did leave out, but there were times when Abraham wouldn't, like when it came to his wife, he didn't believe. When it came to the fact that the king of Egypt was trying to take his wife, he lied, saying that, you know, that was his sister because she was so beautiful that he was afraid that of death in that situation. He was afraid that because back then, if the king liked your wife, he wasn't going to commit adultery, so he'd just kill you so he can have her. You know what I'm saying? So that's not nice. You know what I'm saying? He would kill. So if you had a beautiful wife and the king of Egypt saw your wife and she was attractive, just get rid of him, and now I'm not committing adultery. I just committed a murder, but I guess the murder was better. I don't know. And then we saw him sleep with Hagar. Therefore, we saw him at times struggle with faith, but in his struggle, he was being built up in faith. I want you to understand that there are times that you are struggling in faith, but God is the author and the finisher. And because God is the author and finisher of faith, he's not mad at you when you're struggling, because he's using the struggle to build up the faith. Can I get an amen? God is building up your faith through the struggle. He's building up our faith through the struggle. So I want us to see what that looks like today. How do we grasp that? How do we understand that a little bit today? That God is building up my faith and the things that God is asking me to do. So we're going to start reading at Genesis, the 22nd chapter, and I want you to go ahead and begin to read.
Genesis chapter 22, verse 1. Mm-hmm. Now it came to pass after these things that God tested Abraham, and he said to him, Abraham. And he said, here I am.
Now we said, God did what?
Tested Abraham.
Now we know God does not tempt us, but he does. Because how many of you know to test something is to see faith come by what? Hearing what? God. So God is going to test your faith. Yeah? So I want y'all to understand that we must digest this. God does test your faith. Amen? Because why is God testing your faith? Because God is desiring to build up your faith. And when you test something, you're trying to find out where somebody's at. I mean, you know what I'm saying? When you go into a school, when you go into, I don't care if it's an elementary school, middle school, high school, they test children to find out, they test to find out where are you? Where are you? And in the school, if you're in third grade, you take the FCAT. They take tests to find out where you are, to see if you can pass to go to the next grade, right? Y'all with me, right? You take that. So guess what? God tests your faith too. And we found out this morning that, you know, that faith come by hearing. We found out that the word of God, and you draw nigh unto the word in which I preach to you. You know what I'm saying? And that word that's being preached to you is going to be what?
Tested.
Oh, y'all been hearing? The word that you're sitting up under is going to be tested. It's going to be tested because, remember I told you, we tired. God says, no more lip service. People like to talk about, I'm a Christian. I love God. Isn't it? But when the test come, you're saying that you're a Christian, but you're getting an F. You're saying you're a Christian, but you're getting D's. And if you're getting F and D's, people looking at your life and saying, I hear what you're saying, but it looks like you're failing. It looks like you're not what you say you are. That means you're failing. Everybody understand? But God didn't develop you to fail. Amen? So we see he's testing. Now, this is so funny because Abraham is the father of, and he's being tested by God. So that means if he's being tested by God, he's being tested to be the father of faith. Amen? He's being tested that he's going to, that at the end, you're going to see God manifested through him by faith. Because why would he call him the father of faith if he was not going to operate in faith? Amen? Okay, let's keep reading.
Verse 2.
Uh-huh.
Then he said,
yes,
take now your son, mm-hmm, your only son, Isaac, whom you love, and go to the land of Moriah and offer him there as a burnt offering on one of the mountains of which I shall tell you.
Somebody say, huh? That's crazy. He said, take your only son. Anybody ever wonder, like, isn't that a type error? Why would he say, Abraham, your only son? Because God don't recognize what you're doing in your flesh. Oh, y'all don't like that. People don't like that. God don't recognize. Matter of fact, the Bible is never going to change from God. What you do in your flesh, God is not obligated to bless what you do in your flesh. That's the Bible says, he said, your only son. Now, if he's talking about Isaac, that means he already had Ishmael. Why wasn't God recognizing Ishmael? Why he said your second son? Because that wasn't of the promise. And if it's not of the promise, that means it's of flesh. God is talking to the father of faith in reference to building faith. If God is talking to you about, y'all better get this, we got to grab this. If God is talking to you about faith, to build faith, he's not going to talk to you about what you did in your flesh. He's not going to be trying to include your flesh in his plan. Because he's not the father of flesh and faith. He's not the father of flesh and faith. He's the father of faith. So if he's going to build Abraham up in faith, I'm sorry, that might sound harsh, he's not going to include flesh. And that makes sense, since God said, that makes sense according to Scripture. Why? Because let no man say that God will tempt him with anything evil. Now, some of us may say, well, God, let me tell you, some people like to say, well, you know, God just allowed this to happen. And God just, let me tell you something. That was Abraham's decision and ushered in by his wife, not by God, because they were not willing to stand in faith in that moment. Amen? Y'all with me? That wasn't God's promise. And God don't throw curves inside his promise. But yet, when you and I don't stand in faith, you go out and produce some things that were not of God. Some people are suffering not because God wanted them to suffer. They are suffering because they went out fulfilling their own desires. All has been like that. Don't lie. Tell the truth. Everybody sitting here, how we have created some things in our flesh financially. We have created some things in our flesh. And watch this. But whatever you created is good news. What's the good news? That's not going to deter God's promise. Amen? Amen? So he tells, now this is the thing that's crazy. Now Abraham has the promise. Everybody say Isaac. He has the promise, and God comes to Abraham and say, Abraham, take the promise up to the mountain and what? Sacrifice it. Somebody said, that sounds crazy. Let's read some more.
Verse 3. So Abraham rose early in the morning and saddled his donkey.
So Abraham argued with God. Abraham did what?
Saddled his donkey.
He wasn't slobbing and on the floor screaming, talking about, no, God, not my son. Let's talk for a minute on that. Abraham is told, let me tell you something. I know mothers know what I'm talking about. Mothers and fathers know what I'm talking about, because he's telling Abraham to take his child to the top of the mountain and sacrifice his child. You know what's interesting about that? Some people would perceive that God would never tell somebody to do something like that. And that's why today we have very limited faith. I'm not talking about God telling somebody to take their child up there. But what I'm saying is, some people believe, let's say you get a job. And you was testifying, man, God gave me this job. Oh, my God. You saying, oh, my God, God gave me this job. And now that you have gotten up to $22 an hour, they talking about promoting you, and God says, quit the job. You will have people that come to you and say, that ain't no God. God would never tell you to quit no job after he done put you on there. You started out making $7.89 an hour. You just not getting to $22. You just not starting to roll. You got bills. You got card notes. You got this. That ain't no God. Because we have now listened to a false gospel for so long. What false gospel? That God is like a sugar daddy. And God is all about giving you, like he likes Santa Claus. No, tell him what you want. He going to check the list and check it twice and make sure you've been naughty or nice. He's going to make sure you get whatever you want. So now we got Christians. All they do is sit around saying, God, I want this. I want that. I want this. I want like this. But watch this. Their behavior, this is good. Their behavior does not reflect the God they serve. So they will probably get a naughty. But that's not why God is not adding this and adding that to them. How many of you know that you can get stuff added to you without even serving God? You can go out and, come on, if you got money in the bank, you can go out and buy any kind of car you want. If you got money and you're willing to work hard, you can go get any house you want. You don't have to serve God to go get the house that you want. You can buy any house you want. But what's the problem? The problem would be this. You don't look like God. Though you got the car, you don't look like God. Though you have the house, you don't look like God. Though you got the degree, you don't look like God. So no one is actually benefiting from your life spiritually. Though sometimes you throw a little crumbs because you see somebody ask you for a dollar. And you're like, I'm a good person. I gave that poor man a dollar. But see, the word that God gave us, I feel this in my spirit. When God created man, he had already created the trees. He created the things for man to delight himself in. So the things that God created delight was not stipulated upon God just placed man in that situation. And the word that God spoke over man was, let us create man in our image and after our likeness. And then he said, I'm going to have man have dominion over the things that I've given unto him. But you can't have dominion unless you're in the image and likeness of God. I want to show you something while we keep going, because I see God going to just break this thing all the way down. Stay one hand right there. We're going to keep one finger there, and I'm going to go to Genesis 1:27. It says, so God created man in his own image. In the image God created he him. Male and female created he them. And God blessed them, comma. Who did God bless? No. Who did God bless? I can't hear somebody talk to me. Who did he bless? He blessed them. Who are them? The ones that's in his what? Image. Somebody gonna grab that. He blessed the ones that's in his image to have, to have dominion, which name? So it's the image. That's where the blessed is. Somebody gonna grab it. The image is the blessed. That's where you're blessed. When he said, let us create man in our image, image created. So your blessing is not in the stuff, it's in the image. The first time you ever hear the word blessed is right there. The first time you ever see the word blessed in the Bible is where he is speaking to man who he created in his image and out of woman, man. So in that word blessed means happy, happy, joyful. You're not fully happy and joyful until you are walking in the image of God. For a life to truly be happy and joyful, to be blessed means to be happy, to be joyful. To be fully blessed and to be happy and to be joyful is to be in the image and likeness of God. That's why when you're not in the image and likeness of God, though you have a house, you're not happy, you're not joyful. Though you have a husband, you're not happy and you're joyful, you're not joyful. Though you may have all the money, you're still not happy and joyful. People are still empty because they're not walking in the blessed position they were called to walk in, where the blessing goes. The blessing goes in the image and likeness of God. That's why Paul learned to be content. Why? Paul understood, if I'm in the image of God, I'm blessed if I have not. Stuff don't make me blessed. I'm blessed because I walk in the image and likeness of God. When you see me, you see God. I'm blessed because I'm walking with peace that passes all understanding, joy unspeakable, self-control. I'm walking in the image and likeness of God. And that's why he said happy. You know what? With everything else, he said good. But when it came to man, he said blessed. Everything else was good. But when it came to man, he said, you are happy and joyful when you act and look like me. Many of us called on God because we were living how we wanted to live. And we were not happy. Did you ever think when you were in the world, if I get this, I'm going to be happy? Come on, don't be lying. Let's be fruitful. Some of us are, if I could just get this man right here, if I could get this woman right here, if I could get this job right here, if I could just get this car right here, if I could just get this, if this person would just be my friend right here, if I could just look like this, if I could just look a little like that, if I could just be a little brighter, if I could be a little darker, if I could be a little taller, all these things we were looking, but the Bible says life does not consist in the abundance of things you possess. In other words, you were trying to find things that brought you joy and happiness, but the joy and happiness has to become to the thing that you're called to be in the image of. He blessed them. See, he didn't just say man and woman. He said, I blessed them that I created in my image. How can you not be happy when you're walking around in the image of God himself? Because in him is joy, peace, and love. See, our misery and our pain came from because we tried to find happiness in something other than him. Y'all with me? He's still talking about faith. So I had to, God is just breaking it down. So there, he's talking about blessed. They are blessed. Amen? So let's go back. We understand that we are blessed in his image. And he is calling Abraham. He says to Abraham, he is creating Abraham to be the father of faith. And we said faith. Now, we found out this morning that faith, faith come by hearing the word of God. And then we found out that in the heart, what you believe in your heart unto righteousness, that word that you believe unto righteousness, mean what is righteousness? Jesus took on our sins that we may take on his righteousness. But Jesus Christ is the visible image of the invisible God. Y'all be hear what I'm saying? Jesus Christ is the visible image of the invisible God. So when you accept Jesus, you are fulfilling Genesis 1:20. When Christ steps inside of you, what is the word doing with you? It's building up your faith. It's transforming your heart to produce a behavior that makes you happy and joyful and peaceful. And guess what? No matter what storm comes, because you have been created in the image, no longer I live, but Christ liveth in me. In the life that I now live, I live in faith. What faith come by hearing, hearing the word of God. I hide the word in my heart that I may not sin against him. My behavior now is by the word, for the word is a lamp to my feet and a light unto my path. The word is now that is leading me and guiding me has made my life so much happier, so much more full of joy. I'm not worried about if she's pregnant because I'm not doing something contrary to the word of God. I'm not worried about the police coming at me because I'm not doing something according to the word of God. I mean, opposite the word of God. I'm not worried about a lot of things in the world because why? I'm in this world, but I'm going to this world because I am sanctified by the very word that I believe. Jesus has sanctified me. I'm happy. So I don't get confounded in the things of the world because my happiness didn't come from the world. It came from Jesus Christ. Who is Jesus Christ? The image of God. I foreknew you, predestined you to be conformed to the image of my son, who was the firstborn of my mother, brethren. Meaning what? I foreknew you, predestined you to be conformed to what I said in Genesis. Why? So you can be blessed. So you can be blessed. If you want to be blessed, if you want to be happy, if you want to be joy, then submit, yield yourself to the word of God. And the word of God will take you to a place where peace that passes all understanding. It will take you to a place of joy unspeakable. You will be in this world, but no longer confounded by the world. People are going to wonder why you keep smiling, why you rejoiceful, because your joy coming from the Lord. He neither sleep nor slumber. I know the peace, but I'm going to say it like I to get my point. Listen, but we're going somewhere. We're going somewhere. Keep reading.
So Abraham rose early in the morning and saddled his donkey and took two of his young men with him and Isaac, his son.
Okay.
And he split the wood for the burnt offering.
So they know what he's going to do. The sons know he's putting wood for the offering. He got two of his servants and he got Isaac. Don't nobody know what Abraham will do but Abraham. Let's go.
And he split the wood for the burnt offering and arose and went to the place of which God had told him.
He rose and heading in the direction that God had told him. This is a good word to tell you. Sometimes when God is telling you something, you might not want to tell everybody. Sometimes your fighting battles come from you trying to tell everybody. You're trying to get everybody to believe what God told you, and you don't want us to believe it. So you went out there and told everybody, man, God want me to quit this job. And now you got 15 opinions, and now you can't sleep and you confused when you should have just go quit the job. Calling people, come on, tell me something different. Please tell me God didn't say that. Tell me that wasn't God. And then you're going to find somebody and say, girl, you know that wasn't no God. You know that wasn't no God that would have told you that. What prophesied you that lie? No, he came to me in a dream. Girl, you was dreaming. You probably eating hard. That you ate before you went to sleep, didn't you? Yeah, but I had the same dream 3 times in a row. Well, you know the devil liked to play. Go ahead.
Verse 4.
Right.
And then on the third day, uh-huh. Abraham lifted his eyes uh-huh. and saw the place afar off.
It's kind of funny on the third day, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, on the third day, he found the day that the Spirit was going to have to move. Go ahead.
And Abraham said to his young men, mm-hmm. stay here with the donkey.
Uh-huh.
The lad and I will go yonder and worship.
Stay here with the donkey because the lad and I are going up there to worship. How many know when you obey God, you worshiping? See, we like to think of some worship songs. If you ain't going to obey the word, you ain't worship, man. Forget about worship is a lifestyle. You talk about, man, I'm worshiping. This is worship. That's called praise. Worship is to obey God, reverence his word. He says, stay here while I go obey the word of God. Isn't it funny he connecting worship to obedience to the word of God? He say, stay here while I go reverence and obey the word of God. Worship. We don't turn worship into praise. No, it's praise music. People praising God. To worship is the true worshiper should worship men. Worship is to obey the word of God. When you obey the word of God, know what you're doing? You worship. You're giving him reverence. You're honoring him. Go ahead.
The lad and I will go yonder and uh-huh. worship.
Yeah.
And we will come back to you.
Okay. I want you to underline the part. We'll come back to you. Somebody gonna grab that. He's taking his son up to the mountain to sacrifice him to worship, but he can't lie. He's telling them, oh, we coming back. We coming back. Somebody say, we coming back. See, sometimes you gotta look at people who doubt you and say, oh, I'm coming back. When God starts snatching stuff from you, you need to look and say, I'm coming back. Oh, I'm going to be, when people start doubting what you look like, don't worry about it. When you're doing what God said, people be like, man, you look crazy. Don't worry about it. I'll be back. You better do it honestly. I'll be back. But why was he so assured? Let me explain to you. Remember I told you, why was he so assured that he was coming back? See, y'all don't understand. We're talking about faith. We're talking about image. We're talking about God getting glory. Why was Abraham so assured that we are coming back? Well, let me tell you. See, I want to know. Y'all stay there. Go to Romans 4:19. We're going to read 4:19.
Romans chapter 4, verse 19.
Read it real slow.
And not being weak in faith.
He said, not being weak in faith. He's talking about Abraham, right? Mm-hmm. He was not weak in faith. What happened?
He did not consider his own body.
Let me read it in a broken down version. He considered his own body to be already dead since he was about 100 years old. And also considered the deadness of Sarah's womb. Somebody. Hold on. Let me finish. He staggered not at the promise of God through unbelief, but was strong in faith, giving glory to God. See, Abraham. Let me read it like he gave it to me. Hold up. Stay with me. I'm going to give it to you. He was walking up the mountain with his belief system intact. Abraham was walking up the mountain with his belief system intact. Somebody said, what do you mean? What do I mean? The word says, he staggered not at the promises of God through unbelief, but was strong in faith, giving glory to God. Isaac was birthed out of a dead situation. Isaac was birthed from a man who considered his body to be dead and the wound of his wife to be dead. So Isaac was his belief system. He was being tested on his belief system because Isaac was his belief system. Y'all better hear what I'm saying. If Isaac can be birthed in a dead situation, surely he can be raised again in a dead situation. See, Abraham saying, I know that he was dead. I know that I was 100 years old. I ain't have nothing in me. I know my wife was, her womb was dead and could not produce any life. I want you to get this connected to you. In other words, your faith should be strong in what God is telling you to do because you were birthed in a dead situation. You were born again from a dead wound. You were, the Bible says, we all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. And the wages of sin is death. Everybody in this room, you were dead in your sins. So when you got born again, you received the seed that was being planted in a dead situation. But the seed had power to bring life. How do I know it brought life? Because now you are born again. And you were once dead, now living to the Lord. See, Abraham, he saw Isaac born in a situation where he knew he had no ability to produce that. Nobody in this room had ability to produce your own life being changed. Nobody in this room had the ability to resurrect you from your dead and simple situation. It took God. We found out this morning that he looked at God. What did he tell us this morning? He said, you know what? When we were yet sinners, when your womb was dead and you wasn't birthed in nothing but flesh, God looked past your faults and saw that you needed a live seed. And the seed came into your dead body and woke you up. How do I know what I'm saying is true? Watch this. Read Romans 6:10. 10 and 11.
Romans chapter 6, verse 10. For the death that he died.
Yes.
He died to sin once and for all.
Yes.
But the life that he lives to God.
Yes.
Likewise, you also reckon yourselves to be dead indeed to sin.
How many of us know we was dead in sin? You was dead in sin. There was nothing that you can produce that was going to please God. I don't care that you got a degree. I don't care if you bought a home. It don't matter. There was nothing you can do without Christ that was going to produce you to be in good standing with God. You were going to be in, you and I were in debt, meaning we were dead in our sins, and there was nothing that we can do to bring ourselves back alive. But thank God that he told us this morning that he sent his son. And his son died for our sins. So watch this. Y'all got to get this because I'm almost finished. If Abraham was established in faith in his belief system with Isaac because his faith was built on how Isaac was born, Shouldn't you and I be established in faith in our belief system and anything that God tell us to do because of how we were born? If let me put it this way. If he loved you enough, if he loved us enough to come save you, if he loved us enough to die for us, what is it that he would not give us through his son? Abraham looking at this and saying, wait a minute, we'll be back because I know how you were born. He built my faith up in the way that you were born. He brought you out of dead situation. He spoke a word, and the word came to pass in a dead situation, and you were born. And next thing I know, Sarah womb, and Sarah womb began to come alive, and there was something kicking inside of Sarah womb, and a womb that was once dead. And God says, Abram, you got to know, you got to remember, when you was in the world, you were dead in your sins, and you were birthed in things. That's why he didn't say Ishmael. But we were birthed in all types of Ishmael. We were birthed in Ishmael jobs. We were birthed in Ishmael relationships. We were birthed in Ishmael out of our flesh. But God says, I'm not talking to your flesh no more. I'm talking about the line that you were born in since the beginning. I'm talking about I foreknew you and predestined you to be in the image of my son, to operate according to what you were born to be since the beginning of time, as a daughter and a son of God, living a life that reflects the glory of God. But I had to come get you. You were in a dead situation. What is God saying to the church today? Remember how you were born. And you will have faith for your dying process. Because if the same spirit that raised up Christ abided in me, then he can raise me up out of any situation. What is your testimony? What are you testifying about? That you testifying about, what is your, it's about the blood of the Lamb. It's about when you were dead in your sins and he gave you life. He brought us out of darkness into light. He birthed in us new life. And if he'll do that for you, whatever, and you know how I know what I'm saying is true, watch this. He asked Abraham to offer up the very thing he birthed. Somebody gonna get it. He asked Abraham to offer up the very thing he birthed. That everything that came out of a dead situation, he said, offer it up. Well, let me help you out. The Bible says, you present your body, he's gonna ask you to offer up you. The same way he told Abraham to offer up everything that was birthed out of you, he's saying to you and me, I'm going to ask you to offer, present your body as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable, as your reasonable service. And you know what's funny? Through the process, anybody got saved. And as you got saved, you started, you was rejoiced, your joy came, and you was happy, and you was praising. You got in the choir and all this. And then God all of a sudden came to you and said, quit that. Let that go. What is he doing? Because watch, everything you got after God brought you, he's trying to make sure that you don't love it more than him. He'll say, offer it up. And it's funny that many of us are struggling with the Isaac. We're struggling with the Isaac because we forgot that if you were saved, if he can save you, whatever he's asking from you got to be a blessing to you. Come on. If he was willing to save you, if he offered up his son to save you and to birth life in you when you were dead, what is it that he would not give you through Christ Jesus? See, this is actually a question about people, even if they even saved. Because you know what I come to find out when I listen to this? That many of us don't even value the fact that salvation the very gift that gave us life. Let me tell you something. See, that's because a lot of false gospel out there. And we don't value the gift that gave us life. And the false gospel is saying, Jesus ain't nothing. Where my house? Where my man at? Where my money at? That tells me you have not yet learned Christ Jesus. Because you was dead. And the house couldn't give you no life. Why are you asking God for the things that never gave you life? And then you acting depressed and oppressed. You sad with your walk with God because you don't have stuff. That tells me maybe you still dead. Because if you're still looking for stuff to feel alive, then evidently you didn't get life. That's the true gospel. If you still need something to make you feel alive, that means you don't value the gift that was actually given to you. See, when Isaac was born, to Abraham and Sarah, changes had to come about. One of the first changes that had to come about was they had to get rid of the flesh. Yeah, y'all hear me? One of the first changes that came about when Isaac got born, was get rid of Ishmael and Sarah. Get rid of the flesh. Because the promise in the flesh can't grow together. But some of us, we won't let go of the flesh. You're trying to raise Isaac with Ishmael. And you don't realize they're fighting one another. The flesh is trying to fight for legal rights that it don't have. The promise belongs to the faith, to the promise of God. And you're trying to, and God is trying to get you to release, because it says in the scripture that the flesh and the promise can't exist together. You got to put something out. Look at somebody say, put it out. I got a better word. Look at somebody say, put you out. See, people like, huh? No, I like the way I think. I like the way I act. I like the way I look at people when they get my timing wrong. I like the way I curse you out under my breath. I like the way I have little freaky thoughts in my mind. And God says, but the flesh cannot coexist with the promise. Put it out. Cast it out. Cast the demon out. Rebuke it. What rebuke? Sharply be disapproved or criticize the behavior that it produces. Rebuke the flesh. What does rebuke means? Sharply criticize. Be sharply displeased and criticize the behavior that the flesh produces. In other words, you ought to be displeasure. You ought to be displeased and criticize that which produces a behavior contrary to the seed of God. You ought to be displeased when you see a lie try to come in your house. We ought to criticize when we see lust trying to take over our members of our body. Because what you're allowing to come in is going to produce a behavior that does not reflect the promise in which you were created to be in Genesis 1:27. You were created to be in the image. You're created to be blessed, but when you let your flesh lead, you're no longer blessed, you're cursed. Oh, this is good tonight. Somebody grab me. He's saying, but Abraham said, I want you to sacrifice Isaac. I can picture Abraham. Come on, let's go do this. Why? By that time, his faith had been built up to the point that he wasn't holding on to nothing that God wasn't establishing. By the time he asked to offer up, even though, because God told him to do it, he had to believe his faith. God's, watch this, That's why God said it's time for us to grow. We must grow. Why? Your faith cannot stay at a place where you're not willing to offer up you. We got people here. Okay, God got something to do. God said we got this there. I'm not trying to be funny, but when did your plans become greater than what God was establishing and doing? When did, well, God, I can't make it, or I can't do it. When did we begin to think that God was going to be okay for you to create plans that was in contradiction of some things God is doing? Your obligation is to obey the word of God and to do what God told you to do. Well, I don't feel like telling him I'm sorry because I don't like the way he said it to me. God didn't say, see, you won't, come on, Ishmael, be quiet. Ishmael, be quiet. And now Ishmael fighting with Isaac because Isaac's saying, no, I got to go up to the mountain. I got to do whatever my daddy, bind me up. I got to do whatever my daddy tell me to do. Ishmael like, no, be quiet. We had too many Ishmaels. People that your salvation has come from a fleshly perspective, not a spiritual deliverance. He said, Abraham, I want you to take up Isaac and sacrifice him. Jasmine, I want you to take up Jasmine and pick up a cross and sacrifice her. I want you to sacrifice her desires. I want you to sacrifice her dreams and her hopes. I don't want none of it. Take her up and sacrifice it. But see, Jasmine, her faith, remember I told you, watch this. I want y'all to remember this. She's walking up the mountain with her faith intact. What's intact? Her. She knew, I'm just using this as an example. She knew she was a sinner. She knew she was fornication, adultery. I'm just using it as an example. Fornication, lying, stealing. She knew her old condition, and she knew that the life that she now lives came from him. So whatever he's asking her, she's not afraid, because if he can resurrect her when she was dead, whatever he's asking her to give up, it's got to be best for her new life. For his thoughts to her are not evil, but to give her hope in the future. And see, the problem is some of us, you're still holding on to your flesh, your dreams, what you want. It's all about you. And God has said to you, go up to the mountain, deny yourself, pick up your cross, and follow me to the mountain. And when you get there, present yourself as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable as your reasonable service. Let your mind no longer be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind. Why? How? By drawing nigh to the word and believing in the word that you have received, to the place where it produces righteousness in you. And now confessing salvation, because the righteousness that's produced in you, you now look like what you were called to look like from the beginning of time, Jesus Christ, the image of God. But you don't mind letting go things because you remember what you used to look like. You remember how you were born out of sin and now brought into righteousness. Does this make sense? Let's just read the rest of it so we can get ready to go home.
For the death that he died to sin once and for all. But the life that he lives to God.
So wait a minute. Say it again.
For the death that he died to sin once and for all. But the life that he lives to God.
So now you live unto who? Because you done died unto. Read the next verse before we go.
Verse 11. Likewise, you also reckon yourselves to be dead indeed to sin.
Say, I'm dead to sin.
But alive to God in Christ Jesus our Lord.
But now I live a new life in God, in Christ Jesus. I've been born again. I was dead to sin, but now I've been birthed to a new life. See, that was Isaac. That was Isaac. He was born out of a womb of something that was dead, and life came out of it. So Abraham was walking with his faith intact. You are walking with your faith intact. Because I was born in sin, but I've been resurrected into life. Now the life I live in Christ Jesus. So whatever he requires of me or whatever's going on, I don't mind. Because why? I remember how I was born. I didn't deserve anything I deserved. I was already dead in my sin. Matter of fact, people were saying about me, it's impossible for that person to change. People were saying, nah, she'll never be the same. They were saying about me, you always going to be that way. You ain't nothing. You ain't never been nothing. They was talking about me in such a way that I can't even believe what God has done. Somebody should be shouting in that. Man, they don't know. I used to get liquored up and drunk and sexing and doing it. And now I've been born. I was born out of death into life. Now I don't need no drink no more. I don't need to be sexing no more. And I remember how I was born. So whatever he asks for me now, I know it's whatever he asks. I'm willing to give it up. Why? Because Abraham said, come on, if he was born from death, surely God can resurrect him from death. His faith was to understand that God can surely resurrect him from a dead place since he was born from a dead place. And we can say, surely God can resurrect our finances from a dead place. We were born. I'm sure he can do that if he did it for me, my life. If he can save me, what is it should I be afraid of? What should I be afraid of losing if he can resurrect me? Go ahead, read it. No, go back and read 22 so we can finish that. Because I'm about to tell you and me what's hindering you and I? What may be some of the things that's hindering you and I? Go ahead.
Genesis chapter 22, verse 6. So Abraham took the wood of the burnt offering and laid it upon his son Isaac. Mm-hmm. And he took the fire in his hand and a knife, and the two of them went up together. Mm-hmm. But Isaac spoke to Abraham, his father, and said, my father. And he said, here I am, my son. Mm-hmm. Then he said, look, the fire and the wood, but where is the lamb for a burnt offering?
See, some of us be like, God, all is going on, but where's the sacrifice? What you talking about? What you want, God? No, let me show you. Let me show you how we do it. God, let me tell you what you want. I'm paying my tithes, God. Things seem... God, I'm in the choir. I'm going to church. What is it that you want? What you want, God? I'm paying my tithes. I come to church. I read my Bible at least once every week, twice a week. God, I even fast sometimes. What is it that you want, God? I mean, what do you really want? See, that's what Isaac was saying. I said, I see the fire and I see the wood. He said, the fire and the wood is there, but where's the sacrifice, Father? Where is the sacrifice? And we were like, God, I see the heat coming in my life, God. I see the heat that's got me fasting, God. I see the heat that's got me, I see everything going on, God. But what is it that you really want from me, God? You want more tithes? You want more? He said, no, I want you. You the sacrifice. You are what I'm about to put down. See, in this false gospel, they're not going to say you. They're going to say it's about money and it's about your notoriety. No, what he really wants is you. He want to put you to death. And we're looking around and saying, God, I don't understand what's going on here. I do everything just what you asked me. Where is the sacrifice, God? Because I know it better not be me. I'm still waiting for my 40 acres and a mule. Go ahead.
Verse 8, and Abraham said, my son, God will provide for himself the lamb for a burnt offering.
He said, God gonna prepare. God, so what's funny about it, God is asking you, but he's still preparing for what he really wants out of the deal. Whatever God is taking you through, he's taking you through to get what he really wants out of the deal. Go ahead.
So the two of them went up together.
Uh-huh.
Then they came to the place of which God had told him.
Uh-huh.
And Abraham built an altar there and placed the wood in order.
Uh-huh.
And he bound Isaac, his son, and laid him upon the altar, upon the wood.
Tied him up on the altar. He bound him up. Keep going.
And Abraham stretched out his hand and took the knife to slay his son.
Getting ready to fulfill the word of God. But he had just said, we coming back down. But he remembered where he was born from. He was born from a place of a dead place. So he said to God, if God can surely birth him, he can raise him up again. Abraham was fully convinced that God can raise him up again if he slayed him. Why? Because look how he was born. You got to be surely understand that God can raise your situation up again. Because look where you were born from. Come on. If God can save you from hell, if he can save you from your own sin, if he loved you enough to save you, then what is it that he wouldn't do for you? So why do you look at God when he's mad, when he tell you, let that go? That's not your husband. Leave that alone. No. Turn away. Because you're not really valuing where you were birthed from. See, people who don't value where they were, how many know when we don't value where we were, how we were birthed, then we have what you call an entitlement problem. See, people who don't know how they were birthed and they think they were birthed by doing stuff in church, they believe they have entitlement issues. They believe God owes them stuff. That's how you can discern it in the spirit. When people, religious people, believe God owe them stuff because they believe that, well, I pay my tithes, I go to church every Sunday, I do this, I pray that, you're supposed to give me a husband, you're supposed to do this, you owe me something, God. But what you don't understand is that you were dead in your sins. And when he sent his son to die for you, that your sins, now you were made alive in Christ. You being made alive was somebody dying for you. You are tremendously grateful, overwhelmingly grateful. You can't help but to enter his courts with thanksgiving and praise. Because why? You knew you were dead. You were birthed out of a dead situation. You knew you were sinning. You know when God, you knew your life was full of sin, all kind of flesh and foolishness. And yet he chases you. And loved you to pull you out of a situation where you and I deserve death. And yet, you're going to turn around and be unhappy because he don't give you a wife? As if you have entitlement issues. As if you saved yourself. See, Isaac, he bind Isaac up, but you don't hear Isaac crying because Isaac like, man, I was born. I shouldn't even be here. Isaac like, I shouldn't even be here. My father was 100. My mom's womb was dead. My father, I shouldn't even be here. Come on. Me never said, you shouldn't be here. You shouldn't be in the kingdom. None of us deserve to be called a son and a daughter. But because God's love, when we were yet sinners, he demonstrated his love toward us. That now we may have life in Christ Jesus. We were born out of a dead situation. And now your faith is intact based on your life that you live. You know the life that you live now, you owe that all to God. You're so thankful for the life you live now. You're not worried about saying, see, when you're a woman like the woman of God, she said, well, this is what I used to live, but I'm not worried about no DNA test now because I know the life I'm living now. I know I'm rejoicing because I'm not worried about nobody trying to come at me the wrong way because why? The life I live in faith in Christ Jesus. I got peace that passes all understanding and joy unspeakable. My flesh is no longer leading me down these roads where I got to go through this drama. He said, here, God. Isaac, go ahead, finish it up.
Verse 11. Mm-hmm. But the angel of the Lord called him from heaven and said, Abraham, Abraham. So he said, here I am. Mm-hmm. And he said, do not lay your hand on the lad or do anything to him.
Say, Abraham, you good. Don't do it. You know what's funny? Sometimes a test is to try your heart. I know some of y'all thinking, well, I hope he do the same thing with that job, like when I'm about to go in there, turn that letter, and he say, stop. No, some tests, you're going to turn that letter in. And you're going to be walking out that door with tears in your eyes. I love the Lord. Yeah, he going to tell some of y'all, let that dude go. That ain't the one. Like God, I know you're playing. I know you're going to try to, you're probably going to save him later. And you're probably going to save him later and bring him back to me. No, he's gone. He's gone. He is gone. But God, I heard he got saved. Yeah, but he's still gone for you. He's not yours. I'm going to tell you something. Watch out for that spirit of entitlement. How do you avoid the spirit of entitlement? Always being grateful for the birth. Always be thankful and grateful for the birth. See, I look at it like this. You tell a woman she can't have no children because, let's say, one of her ovaries or something messed up. And when she and God come and say she can have a child, that woman, look at that child. She named that child's name Joy, whatever, because she knows that there was nothing in the natural that could have produced what she had. See, when you know that there was nothing in the natural that could produce your salvation, there was nothing, there was no, all the money in the world, all the degrees, everything in, there is nothing in this world that could have produced your salvation. That means you could have fed the hungry, did 100 good deeds, and yet did all the wonderful things, and yet you would still perish and go to hell because salvation had to be purchased by a spotless, spotless lamb. It had to be, the offering had to be equivalent to what it was purchasing. That's why God had to come himself. He offered up himself that you and I may have salvation in him. And let me tell you something. A leg growing back is not more important than that. Eyes being able to see is not more important than that. The greatest gift is the gift that was given unto us through Jesus Christ's salvation. How many get what I'm saying? That's the greatest gift. The greatest gift. The greatest gift. The greatest gift was given to us through Jesus Christ. Please don't. Watch it. Do you believe that? No. Do we believe that the greatest gift that God gave you and I was life in Jesus Christ? Do you really, really believe that? Do you confess with your mouth and believe in your heart that Christ was raised from the dead and in him there is salvation? Do you? I would have you believe that most Christians don't believe that. How, you say, why would you say that? Because most Christians are not happy about the death of Jesus Christ. Most Christians have not accepted Christ to the place where, remember, he says, you believe unto righteousness. What you believe produces a behavior. Like, hold it, just tap on something like that. Hold it out like just a tap, just tip it. If I believe that's mine, I'm going to get it. It produces a behavior. What you believe produces a behavior. See, this false gospel going on today, it's believing what they, it believes what they want, but it doesn't believe what the word says. Y'all better hear what I just said. It believes what they want, but it doesn't believe what the word says. What do you mean? It believes that, okay, God, I want this. God, I want that. God, I want this. But it doesn't believe that, guess what, that you can stop lying. It doesn't believe that you can walk holiness. It doesn't believe that you can operate, that you can actually come from a dead state of sin and now, watch this, walk in righteousness. Ooh, that's awesome. You and I came from a place where we were sinners. Amen. How many sinners in the house? Used to be sinners. We came from a place of sin and death, and because of Jesus Christ, we now walk in righteousness and life. Come on, man, that's off the chain, and we didn't pay a dime for it. But watch this. If you believe it, you believe it unto righteousness. What is righteousness? The righteous way of living, the word of God. It was counted to Abraham, the father of faith, as righteousness because he believed God. Y'all believe what I just said? It was counted to Abraham as righteousness because he believed God. When you believe God, it is counted unto you as righteousness. What do you believe? That Jesus Christ paid it all for you. So if he paid for sin for you, why do you continue in sin when you're free? Why do we continue in sin when we're free? If he paid for it, that means you sin free. Shall we continue in sin? God forbid. Why? You're free. The worst thing to have is a mind still in prison when you're free. A heart still in prison when you're free. There are white people in prison because they're not free. There are black people in prison because they're not free. There are Spanish people in prison because they're not free. Because their mindset is not in alignment with the word of God. When you hate people, you're in prison. When you won't forgive, you're in prison. Though you've been set free by forgiveness, you would choose not to exercise the forgiveness, which causes you to be in prison. Do we understand this? But you are other children of the promise. You're the children of Abraham of the promise. You're not the children of the faith. I mean, you're not the children of flesh. You've been born again. He said, Isaac, I don't mind offering up Isaac. Why? Because my faith is intact. I know that God, he was born from a dead place. So if I kill him, God can raise him up again. I'm just obeying God. So guess what? If God killed my attitude, if he killed my selfishness, that's okay because he's going to raise you up again. Sometimes we hold on to things because that's the way we fight. We don't want nobody to... We learn how to fight. We know how to hide our insecurities. We know how to curse people out. We hide. And God is trying to get us to grow. Amen. Go ahead. The last part. I think it's a little bit more, and that's it.
And he said, "Do not lay your hand on the lad, or do anything to him." Mm-hmm. For now I know.
About somebody look and say, now I know. Say, now I know. Some of us in this room, your hindrance is because God has not yet got you to that place where now I know. Your hindrance from being free and being able to walk in the power and the authority God wants us to walk in is that God has tested you, but yet you held on to the thing that God wanted you to let go. And God says, I can't trust you yet. I can't trust to elevate you when there's still too much of you there. But then he says that when Abraham was willing to offer up Isaac, when he was willing to offer up the thing he loved, see, what do you love? You love yourself. See, if you're not willing to offer up yourself, God says, I don't trust you. You'll take around and you'll turn around and use my power to glorify you. You will have people worshiping and following you. But see, when God tries you and says, let that go, release that, and you obey God because you understand how you was born, come on. He has built your faith up because, watch this, because when you were sin, come on now, you got to understand something. The things that God asked you to let go couldn't give you life in the first place. Amen? I love my wife. My wife didn't give me no life. Don't ever get that twisted. She didn't give me no life. I had life when I met her, and so did she. Anytime you meet a man and woman, and they sit and talk about, girl, you my whole life, that's carnal and foolishness. You ain't, what, you can't even, how's she going to be your life? If you drop dead, what's she going to do to bring you back alive? Be down there talking about, whoo, whoo, whoo. What you, so when you stand before God, what you think? Your wife, or husband going to be like, God, this is my wife. I believe she shouldn't go to hell. You believe, why do you believe she, you know God's going to be logical. I'm like, God, I'm loving. So why do you believe she shouldn't go to hell? Because God, I love her. Okay. And your love did what? Well, I was there for her for 40 years, and I took care of her, and I God, I'm like, isn't that what you were supposed to do? Yeah. So, God, I think she should go to heaven with me.
There is no marriage in heaven.
Did she accept Jesus? No, God, but I did. Well, I'm glad you're going in. You want to say your goodbyes right now? See, y'all think it's a joke. Y'all think it's funny. She going to hell. She going to hell because there's only one way to get to heaven. That's through Jesus Christ. I don't care what men think. God don't care nothing about what no man think. Who is man to God but something he formed from the dust and into his body and made him a living soul? We don't dictate to God. He dictates to us. That's just the truth. You ain't, watch this. You don't have to believe it. You don't even have to accept it. It won't change the fact that it's true. So a good husband gonna leave his family an inheritance. What? He gonna live God before him. He gonna be the first one on the knees in the morning time. He gonna be the first one having Bible study with his wife. He gonna be the first one laying hands on his children. Why? Because he want to make sure that they get something exceeding just this junk down here. Yes, he don't mind if they get the 100. They don't mind if they get the tennis shoes. But a good father who knows Christ can know the tennis shoes ain't going to get you into heaven. He don't mind that they go to college, but he going to give them a college fund. That's because you go to college, but that's okay. Because if he do all that and they never accept Jesus Christ, they still going to hell. A good father gonna make sure that his children have the gift of eternity through Christ Jesus. So what good is it that I provided everything she needed here? I bought her a mansion, 12 bedrooms, and 5 baths. I gave her the Rolls Royce. She had a Rolls Royce and a Beamer outside. She had the finest jewelry. When she walked out the house, everybody says, oh, look at Miss Glean. I mean, she had everything her heart desired. But you never told her about Jesus. You never lived Christ before her. You never lived Christ before your children. You never lived Christ before your mother. You never lived Christ before anybody. And yet all of them perish because you just offered them things that can fade away. So you were happy for 40 years, but now you will spend eternity in hell because you said, God, I got this. So Abraham said, I offer up the thing I love the most because I have faith that you can raise up the dead things. God is asking everybody in this room, including me, because I promise you this. I say this to the babies, to the adults, and the babies, nothing. Every man and woman in this room going to have a moment of now I know. God is going to try your faith. He's going to test. Think it not strange when trials come to. When you hear the word, you're going to. Come on, it makes sense. When you go to school, don't they give you tests? You sit in the classroom and then they give you a test. Why? To see if you can pass, if you have the knowledge to be what you want to be. The job give you tests. When I was at the sheriff's department, if you had to go to another department, you had to what? Get a new manual, you had to take tests, you had to, why? They got to make sure you qualified to do that. So God is giving you tests to make sure that you're able to what? Qualify to represent by demonstrating who you say you believe in. But God is not mad. Say, God is not mad. He know we children. And he know he has to raise us up. That's why he says, I'm the author and the finisher of your faith. I'm going to bring you up. I'm going to have your faith where it needs to be. So stop worrying. Just submit. Just submit and say, God, I need you to help. I need you to help me get me where you want. I need you to help me. Because I wasn't born. Remember, I was born just like we was in sin. But I remember my birth. That's why I know God to take me where I'm going. I remember I don't deserve anything. I was a liar, cheater. I did me. What I deserve is death. But he gave me life. Amen? All us in this room deserve death. But he gave us. So when he asks you to give up some things in life, don't you dare tell God no. He said, Abraham, now I know. What he said, now I know what?
Now I know that you fear God.
That you fear God. Now I know who you really reverence. Now I know who you really respect. Now I know who you really honor. See, we can't fool God. We can't fool God. He know that you honor that car more than you honor him. He know you honor that husband more than you honor him. He know you honor that making money more than you honor him. Why? Because if they ask you to work overtime on Sunday, you ain't got no problem telling God I ain't coming to hear nothing you got to say. And in your mind, you don't even think there's nothing wrong with that. God, I ain't got time to hear you, but faith come by. And then you wonder why you can't grow. That same job that when they get tired, they'll cut you loose. And they don't care nothing about it. You done gave them 15 years. Will cut you loose and say, see you. But you was totally dedicated to it. You put nothing before God. Because without God, you have no life. You have a form and a fashion, but you have no real life. And you continue to look for things that make you happy because you're not blessed. But God called you to be blessed. He said, let us create man in our image. And he said, he blessed them. Every man in this room, God designed you to be blessed. Every woman in this room, you were designed to be blessed. You were designed to be in the image and likeness of God. Amen? Don't struggle with what God said. God, let it go. Let it go. Let you go. let you go. This last, what's funny about this, I was talking to one of my daughters today, and we were talking about, I don't know why God, it's funny how God preached something and he kind of illustrated it. And the girl on Facebook, and the girl was on there talking about, and God don't choose your wife. God don't choose your husband. God don't choose your job. God don't choose nothing. You got to, God don't even choose for you to have salvation. God don't even choose. God won't even make the choice for you for salvation. He offered you, but he don't choose. And you know what? She was right in this sense. She was right in the sense of the fact is, she was right from a perspective of somebody unsaved. Because when you're unsaved, you're making all those choices. But when you became saved, once you said, Jesus Christ, you are my Lord, you don't call him Lord and do what you want to do no more. Because Lord means ruler. Once you call him Lord, and you say, Lord, not my will, but thy will be done. And then he said, watch what he asked you. Once he saved you, then he said, give me your life. I want to take you up to the highest mountain and bound you up and sacrifice you. And we're like, God, no, but I like my attitude. No, God, I like sex. No, God, I like lying. No, God, don't bind me up. He said, you want to become great? Yeah, I want to become great. Then let me take you out. And let me resurrect you in me. Let me resurrect you in the man that you were called to be from since the foundation of the world. Let me resurrect. Let me get rid of you. Because it's you that's been causing the problem. It's the way you think, the way you answer questions, the way you think about women, the way you think about men, the way you think about money, the way you think. It's you the problem. Let me get rid of you. Let me get rid of your ideology. And watch this. Pride be like, nah, I'm good. I don't need no God. I got this. Until something comes that you realize, no matter how strong, how smart, how much you, because there's always something that can come that will challenge how great you think you are. And then all of a sudden, you like Jesus. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Isn't it funny? Isn't that what happened to some of us? Something came that challenged where you at. And you was like, I need something greater than me. And then the world in their ignorance talking about, you using God, that's your crutch. What you talking about? You use drugs, alcohol, women, and such. You use stuff. You shut up. You use money as a crutch. You don't feel like nothing unless you got a dollar in your pocket. You let a green dollar tell you that you're somebody. I don't need a dollar in my pocket to know I'm somebody. It's a terrible thing to find your identity in something that can be taken from you. Because that means once it's taken, you go back to zero. God is good. If there's anybody in the house, listen. God is building up your faith.